Super Typhoon Mawar likely to enhance a southwest monsoon or habagat, bringing rains to the northern part of the country, including Metro Manila. State Weather Bureau Pagasa said Mawar, which was last seen east of Visayas, may enter the Philippine area of responsibility by the end of the week and will be called Betty. Now, Pagasa adds the storm may also trigger the start of the rainy season in the country.
Yung nakikita nating scenario is that magiging mabagal ang pagkilos nito once na halos malapit na ito dito sa may bandang southern part of Taiwan. So may tendency itong mag-enhance ng habagat. And possibly by next week, Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, ito yung magdudulot naman ng mga pag-ulan sa ilang bahagi ng ating bansa, lalo na yung mga lalawigan sa kanlurang bahagi and possibly including Metro Manila. Si Super Typhoon Mawar, pwede niyang i-trigger yung habagat na siya magdudulot ng pag-ulan at possibly mag-udyat ng simula ng rainy season natin. So patuloy tayong mag-monitor and magbibigay ng update regarding the start of rainy season and yung status po nitong Super Typhoon Mawar from time to time.
Mawar is barreling towards Guam, threatening to slam into the U.S. territory as the strongest storm there in decades. It is packing winds equivalent to those of a Category 4 hurricane. The Philippine Energy Department says it is not in favor of revoking the franchise of the country's sole power grid operator. But Energy Undersecretary Sharon Garin asserts the franchise of the National Grid Corporation of the Philippines, or NGCP, must be thoroughly reviewed. She says there is a need to strengthen the authority of government over the entity. She also explains why she called the franchise given to NGCP generous.
Ang taxes nito is 3% in lieu of everything. So hindi na magbabayad yan ng corporate income tax, kahit mga real estate tax, lahat sa local sales tax, everything. Why was it like that? I think that is one incentive that we gave it to them. No? It was purchased, I think, around $4 billion. That's a huge investment, and someone was willing to, a private entity, to undertake the huge responsibility. So part na rin yan ng, ano, ng incentive sa kanila. But also now, if you look at the subsequent franchises that were given by Congress, I don't think I've seen anything like that, na 3% siya. So it's time to review.
Garin, though, is not keen on having another entity that will operate the country's power grids.
It's more efficient and more less expensive for everyone if we only have one grid. If there's only one grid, you can synchronize and harmonize all the powers that are being generated. So if there's one operator and one grid, so we can maximize the utility as long as the building of the infrastructure of the grid and the generation are in sync. But now, since there are delays in the grid construction, medyo nagkakaproblema tayo.
The Philippine Coast Guard now probing the source of the oil spill detected in two towns in Batangas. Teams were deployed Tuesday to the towns of Calatagan and Mabini to contain the oil spill. The PCG says it is looking into whether the oil came from nearby factories or ships that passed by the province's waters. Batangas Coast Guard officials have also ruled out the possibility of the oil slick coming from the oil spill in Oriental Mindoro. Now, according to the PCG, the incident in Batangas is not yet alarming and that it is still under control. The Asian Development Bank will provide up to $4 billion in grants to the Philippines this year to support the Marcos administration's socio-economic agenda. They may include projects that address the climate change problem and food security issues, among others. That announcement was made by ADB President Matsusugu Osakawa during the reception at the bank's headquarters last Monday, with President Marcos himself in attendance. The ADB is the country's top source of active official development assistance among 20 development partners last year. Philippine authorities begin investigating the massive fire that raised the Manila Central Post Office. The Bureau of Fire Protection is set to examine several pieces of debris recovered from the post office to determine the cause of the blaze. But an initial assessment showed the decades-old building had no fire suppression system. The Philippine Postal Corporation on the defensive.
during the 1970s po, nung itinayo kasi yung building code, there was no sprinklers, no? And it became a heritage site no 2018. It's very hard to put up all of those sprinklers.
Damage assessment of the Manila Central Post Office is also underway. The Government Service Insurance System says it may take 2 weeks before it could finalize the insurance claim for the post office building. This as entry to the building remains limited due to safety concerns.
The whole coverage is 604 million. No? The building is insured for 406 and 198 for the contents. When you say the contents, these are the tables, these are the fixtures that you have inside. As the adjuster mentioned, it does not cover the letters or whatever parcels that are inside. Sisiguraduhin po natin dito ay maibigay yung insurance. At hindi lang po yun. Ang importante dito ay you have to take note that this is an important cultural property.
Yes.
And we should be quick to be able to restore the morale and dignity back of not only the Postal Corporation's team members, but of the whole country. And that's why we immediately asked, and the board immediately said, okay, we're committed to assist the Philippine Postal Authority by lending them money. The moment ma-assess na nila kung anong you know, plans or ano yung mga how the whole building inside will be looking like, we're prepared to help them out.
Philippine lawmakers also seeking a congressional probe into the Manila Central Post Office fire. House Committee on Creative Industry and Performing Arts Chairperson Christopher De Venecia is set to file a resolution to appeal for an investigation. Manila's 6th District Representative Bienvenido Abante also joined calls for a probe.
I made some proposals in my privilege speech yesterday that we should now look into all of the iconic landmarks and national heritage sites all over the country. Mm-hmm. We immediately evaluate, especially concerning structural and electrical soundness and integrity, safety and health issues, as well as beauty. I made a proposal that a private foundation, duly registered with the SEC, in partnership with the government, be given the privilege and authority to administer and manage this iconic landmark and national heritage. I even volunteered to help put up the foundation, to partner with government and the private sector, with the sole purpose of mission of restoring, repairing, renovating, beautifying, preserving, and maintaining all of the iconic landmarks and national heritage all over the country.
The National Museum declared the Manila Central Post Office an important cultural property back in 2018. A cultural organization also suggests tapping the private sector to rehabilitate the historic landmark. But Renacimiento Manila says these factors should be taken into consideration in the building's restoration.
Although it's no longer that much use as it was before, it still has a story to share. The structure itself and the functions of each room is still fascinating. Just entering to the main lobby or to the colonnade, you get an idea of the scale of this imposing American period neoclassical structures. If we are going to turn it into, for example, a balance of a museum, then we should integrate postal history to the story of it. And in terms of design tweaks, for us, no, it's important to preserve the structure to this, but there, since we now have the opportunity to integrate modern mechanisms that were not integrated before, but better fire prevention system.
The Philippine Social Welfare Department orders the closure of an orphanage in Quezon City due to alleged violations. The SWD Secretary Rex Gachalian said the Gentle Hands Orphanage has disproportionate number of children and helpers. According to Gachalian, the facility was housing 149 children, nearly double the maximum 80 children it was supposed to be taking care of. Gachalian also pointed out the facility has sealed fire exits and is littered with trash. Meanwhile, the facility's executive director, Charity Hepner Graf, denies the agency's claims. She also slams the DSWD's move, saying it may subject the children to trauma. State Pension Fund GSIS hopes more clarity on a proposal to reform the military pension system. GSIS President and General Manager Jose Arnulfo Veloso says the measure needs to be ironed out on whether they will be the ones managing the funds for the uniformed personnel's pension. If the GSIS will be tasked to handle the funds, Veloso says they will need fresh financial infusion from the government.
Kung kami po magmamanage ng pondo na ito, hindi po namin imimix yung pondo ng ating government employees with the military and uniformed personnel. There should be no commingling of funds that we're going to do. And we will require infusion of fresh funds from the national government to be able to address this. Kasi po, ang role po namin is fund manager. Kaya ibig sabihin ng fund manager, will take care of investing. Talagang unsustainable. Kaya nga po napunta ito sa diskusyon at ang atin pong Secretary of Finance is concerned about this primarily because of the amount that is being called from the national budget. And they're not thinking of the current ones, but the future. The future of the country is what they're looking at.
The Philippine House Ethics Committee will once again probe the continued absence of embattled lawmaker Arnulfo Teves Jr. The hearing is set to take place Monday, May 29th, with an aim to come up with a recommendation to the House plenary by the last session day on May 31st. The panel says Teves' continued absence may be considered disorderly behavior. The panel is also looking into Teves' failed request for political asylum in Timor-Leste. Teves remains outside of the country as he faces murder raps over the assassination of Negros Oriental Governor Ruel de Gamo and nine others. The Philippine Justice Department, unfazed by the recantations made by some of these suspects in the de Gamo killing. Three more suspects retracted their confessions. They are now claiming they were coerced by police into naming suspended lawmaker Arnulfo Teves Jr. as the mastermind. The DOJ says they have not officially received the affidavits yet, but they are confident the recantation will not affect the merits of the case.
So tingin namin wala naman siyang epekto dun sa kaso, no? Kasi naniniwala kami na ang ebidensyang hawak ng department sa ngayon ay matibay at kahit na pa merong umatras o may bago ng kanilang salaysay, hindi ibig sabihin ito na totally masisira yung kaso.
A Philippine Senate committee eyes legalizing motorcycle taxis and courier services after a four-year pilot study. Motorcycle services were first allowed to operate in 2019 under a six-month pilot program to test their safety and was extended for several years. Legislation to make the services legal also remained pending. Public Services Committee Chairperson Senator Grace Bo says, while motorcycle taxis are a viable source of income and there is certainly demand for the service, much still needs to be done to ensure safety standards are upheld.